Final panel, welcome back. My name is Richard Scaife, CEO of Yovo, world's first tokenized mobile network, for those of you who were not in the room earlier on. Final panel today, and we're going to be talking about the opportunity. My own personal perspective, this is Internet 3.0. It is the Internet of money, and it's a seismic change in the way that the Internet, the foundation, will work. I was actually having a conversation with somebody outside, and they're saying, I feel like I've missed the boat. It's all too late. Everything's already happened. I said, well, let's kind of wind it back. And if you were to sort of talk about your 56K APS dial-up modem and what the internet looks like now, I think right now we are actually at the dial-up modem stage. We look at the challenges that the main nets are actually facing, dealing with congestion, the slowness of the transactions, the kind of the new fast hyperledgers have yet to kind of come into reality. And you talk an awful lot about Bitcoin, so I'm going to start with you first of all.
Okay.
Do you think, are we too late? I mean, is the opportunity, has it already happened? The bubble's burst?
Well, I'm a trader and I'm not selling. I get asked all the time, is it too late to get in on Bitcoin? I said, well, I'm not selling, I'm actually trading to get more Bitcoin. So my bullish view on Bitcoin comes from the fact that the way technology is and the way computers and machines to machines, previously I was with Jamie Burke from Outlier Ventures, who are a venture fund based in London who focus primarily on blockchain.
Yeah.
And they're invested in IOTA, which is not a project I particularly like, but it allows for free, fast transactions. We need, for the way computers are moving and internet-connected devices are moving, we need machine-to-machine payments.
Yes.
So,
what does that look like? Talk me through a machine-to-machine payment.
Well, let me just explain this first. Yeah. So the reason I'm so bullish is that the only way we're going to achieve machine-to-machine payments at low-cost fast transactions globally is by having a global currency.
Yeah.
And the only way you can have a global currency that works is to be decentralized. If you have a global currency managed by a country, it will be managed within their interest. If you have it managed by the UN or the IMF, it will be politically motivated. The only way you can have a truly global currency is to be decentralized. And for me, that sits on three levels. You will have a global store of value which provides liquidity across all blockchain, which is Bitcoin.
It's Bitcoin, sorry.
And then you will have peer-to-peer payments, which may end up being Bitcoin Cash for whatever the arguments are.
Or Bitcoin Lightning.
Or Litecoin, you're about Lightning Network?
Yes.
Okay. But also you will have some kind of tangle which will provide machine-to-machine payments. So I'm bullish because the world needs it and it has to happen. Speculation means it looks crazy, but the argument for 100k Bitcoin and also a million dollar Bitcoin is perfectly valid for me. Hence, I'm not selling.
Okay,
that's helpful.
That's not investment advice.
No.
machine to machine payments.
Yes.
The future. Let me put this into simple terms. This is my toaster paying my fridge.
Yes, but probably more like your Tesla charging. This is more like your, I always think the car is the best example. The friction you have with the car actually going and paying for things is kind of ridiculous. You should be able to just pull up, charge your car and pull away, and the car knows the charger station and pays it. Or if you're going into a toll road, you go straight through and the car knows it. That to me is the best example of machine-to-machine payments on a consumer level. But there are business-to-business solutions. But it's anywhere where a transaction, I mean, it's actually quite archaic that we're getting out and giving cards across when technology will allow it not to happen. It'll be years away, but that's to me is machine-to-machine payments.
So the vast majority of people in this audience, I think, from sort of the games industry, where do you see the big opportunity in the game space if you have to kind of call a potential direction?
So interestingly, I think the games industry is one of the best for cryptocurrencies in that you have a global community competing and playing games, trading assets and skins.
So we're talking here about currency or crypto assets?
Well, two things. Let me talk about currency first. So I was with the fund I trade for out here in Santa Monica. I was with them last week and I met the guy who did the ICO for Wax. I don't know if you guys know Wax, but they do the skins. And he said the thing that crypto has solved for them is you've got a guy in Korea buying something off a guy in Brazil for $1. And if you try and do that with a fiat currency, everything's getting eaten up by transaction fees. Whereas if you deposit in crypto and you pay in crypto, you save that. So that's the first opportunity in terms of currency supporting global ecosystems. The second is obviously tokenization of projects has allowed a new economy to exist. The most important thing is if you are going to use a token for any kind of business is to understand the utility of the token and actually have a proper crypto economic model for what your token does, because eventually 90 to 95% of these tokens are going to go to nothing because most of them are debt tokens.
They're vicious circles.
They're just debt tokens with little or no value, and these debt tokens will only have value based on the velocity of the computer system that drives usage, and most of them will not have the velocity to support it. So those hoarding the coins or holding them as some kind of short-term store of value, when the market matures in the next year to 2 years, we'll start to see that most have little to no value. Okay. So understanding the crypto economics, and there's a book by a guy called Chris Benetsky, which is about crypto asset valuation, is well worth a read.
Super, thank you very much. So we're going to swap over to the games world. Tell us a little bit about your project. What are you doing?
I'm currently, it stretches back to last August at the developer conference when I went to Tony and I said, what are you up to? And he goes, I'm doing an ICO. And I had no idea what he was talking about. Since that time, obviously, he was successful in his ICO. He kept in contact about it. And I'm now personally involved in quite a large ICO myself. So going from a standing start and knowing nothing, going through a hugely massive, steep learning curve, I'm now very much involved in an ICO. I see it as a great way for our business, as has been pointed out. We already have virtual currencies in all the mobile games. So it's a good fit, probably more than any other business. But now encountering all of the challenges that perhaps Tony didn't have back in last year, where the landscape has changed so much. When he was raising his ICO, there were how many a week?
Not many.
Yeah,
I'd probably say a handful a month.
A handful a month. Now there are dozens every week, and probably more than that. So it's a question now, it's become a lot more challenging, and I'd equate it to, in some ways, to the early days of Kickstarter, where there was a gold rush and it was an easy way of raising money, and then it got to saturation, a lot of people were let down, and investors are being a lot more cannon now. So it's not an easy way of raising money, and I think there's a misconception that an ICO is a great way for games companies to raise money. It is, but it's not easy, and also it's not cheap to actually orchestrate the whole fundraise. I could elaborate for a long time on it, but the challenges are there that perhaps weren't there last year, and
the two men in the white paper days are over.
Absolutely, and you also got to realise you need experts on board, blockchain engineers, for instance.
They're cheap.
They're really cheap because there aren't many of them. There are not many who've actually successfully been part of a successful ICO, and the same with marketing people, etc., etc.
To that point, actually, and again, everybody's got to go out and recruit technical talent. I was talking to recruiters about this, and they said, you know, they took a very, I want people with 5 years of experience, and I'll tell them, I'll tell them what the deal's going to be, and it's just like, you do realise that somebody with 5 years of experience in this space is independently wealthy if they believe in blockchain.
Yeah.
Why? This thing called Bitcoin, there's a really good chance that they actually got into it 5 years ago.
Absolutely.
If they claim to have 5 years worth of experience.
Absolutely.
So recruiting people is very different. Have you looked at sort of token allocations for your team? Is that something which
Absolutely.
Motivate them?
I mean, financially, you can figure out all the rewards, and obviously you've got to incentivize the right people. But the simple fact is, not many people exist with experience because the ICO is obviously a relatively new phenomenon. And finding someone with that experience, they may not be wealthy because they were they understood blockchain, they were able to technically help the ICO company develop the back end, and they were rewarded however they're rewarded, not necessarily by a load of tokens or anything else. So they may not have made their money then, but they can make their money now, because now being a lot cannier and understanding the opportunity, they can demand a lot more than perhaps they could have done last year when it was relatively new.
So, I mean, again, this panel is talking about the opportunity, and I mean, when you're joining a startup, an early stage company, generally equity is a big part of what the founders want to keep, what the venture capitalists want to take, and what the staff feel that they should rightfully be given to them. I hosted a panel last week. I had the boss of Seedcamp, I had the boss of Techstars on that panel. We were talking about tokens. We're talking about, for the first time, these major players in the very, you know, the highly respected early stage space are looking at tokens. Are tokens something that, you know, you interest you, Jake? You're at Reality Clash. Did you have a difficult conversation with Tony about your token allocation?
Is that a public thing to talk about?
we discussed. Yeah, I mean, I joined. I'm the community manager for Reality Clash. I joined the project just at the start of the token sale. I come from a background of being a crypto trader myself, and I am quite bullish on Bitcoin as well, especially now that we've dipped to this point, and it's a HODL kind of...
It's gone back up.
Oh, we're back up then. Nice, yeah. It'll happen in 2 minutes, it'll be back down. The volatility.
The dips are good for ICOs, I think. Actually, they move people into altcoins.
I mean, it's been very strange the way the kind of... Bitcoin and all the altcoins correlate with each other, because it used to be, a few years ago, it used to be quite simple, as in if Bitcoin was going up, the altcoins would go down. And then now it's kind of, if people are confident in the price of Bitcoin going up, you then see all the altcoins start to rise now. But then it can be completely disconnected, and that can be totally irrelevant information. So yeah, the trends in following those and trading has changed quite a bit. And I think part of that is a lot of new people coming in with a lot of money, whether that's kind of institutional investors or not, that's kind of more your everyday man who's coming in, jumping in on Coinbase and then asking their friends, "Oh, what coin should I buy?" I'm part of quite a few Facebook groups which are just cryptocurrency based, and you'll see the most common thing I think it's ever posted about cryptocurrency is just what coin, when moon, and these are like legitimate questions. It's not someone joking around and making a meme. They are just saying to you like, when is this going to happen?
Well, yeah. I read a fascinating piece at the moment. There's not a lot of signaling and market intelligence out there in terms of what cryptocurrencies are going to get the big sort of wave of adoption. And I was seeing that people are simply making the decision around the size of the Telegram group.
Yeah.
They're not bothering with the white paper. The name of the project sounds interesting, and they've got 50,000 people in the Telegram group. It's going to be big. Bye.
Yeah. I mean, that is unfortunately, or fortunately, depending on which side of the trading side you are, it's a difficulty, because from my experience with community management with Reality Clash, you've had possibly 60 to 80% of people who have joined the ICO, or the token sale rather, and all they want to do is get 100 times return the next day, and they don't understand that you've said to them, the game comes out next year, 2018, Q3, and they will say to you the day after the token sale, when's the game out? Like, why hasn't it been released yet? Why aren't you on this exchange? Why aren't you on that exchange?
I've seen people in community channels having difficulty understanding as to why it's not listed on an exchange when they've yet to issue the tokens.
It's a fortunate and unfortunate thing that you have people who are putting a lot of money in, or you have some people who have put money in early on. So you might have somebody who's put $100 or $200 in, you know, a couple of years ago and kind of forgotten about it, and then come back now and realize that $200 could be worth, you know, $100,000, $200,000 or more. So then you have these people who actually have no kind of financial sense or investment technique or anything like that, and they just literally will throw 10 grand into a coin or into an ICO, because it's not real money to them, because obviously their percentage increase on their $200 means that they can chuck 10 grand into something. But then it comes with them not really knowing what they're doing, and therefore then coming to you and saying, why hasn't this happened? Why hasn't that happened?
So you're on the sharp end of
the
community. Anyone turned up at your door yet?
No, fortunately not, no. I joined the team when the token sale had just started, and I was working kind of, my hours were a bit strange. It was like 10 a.m. to 5 a.m. So then I would kind of sleep for 4 hours, and then I'd just kind of be available again. because as I think Tony Morton was alluding to, like, it is an international, token sales international, so you have people from all across the world who are messaging you at all times, and they want to be answered immediately. And you know, any advice to someone doing a token sale is you have to be responsive. So you have to, if somebody messages you and says, like, I need this information, and you don't get back to them within 6 hours or even less, they might just decide, oh, well, I'll go and look something else. Because it is so fluid, this market. It is a case of, you know, sometimes you'll jump from three different coins in a day. It's so quick. And unfortunately, as I said, the people that might come along with that are quite impatient, and they want results now.
So we're looking at a world where, you know, we talked about it earlier, where people of a certain age or a certain sort of profile are viewing assets in a very, very sort of different way. The digital asset becomes actually for them very tangible, very real.
Yeah, I think it's been discussed all of this afternoon about kind of instead of talking about in-game items, we should be calling them digital assets, especially if they're on a blockchain. We've already discussed, obviously, the value that gets added to the network itself, but also to the items and also to the users. We know from statistics that, you know, people retain those items and actually value them. And as a gamer myself, I know, like, I have probably like $150 worth of items on CSGO. And I haven't sold them. I could sell them and then get other games or do other stuff with it. I could take it out to CSGO skins or whatever and sell it for real money there or Bitcoin. But I kind of earned them, so it's kind of like they're mine. You know, I like having a little stat track on my M16 or whatever, and it's nice. So I think we've shifted, and I think cryptocurrency is very indicative of this. We've shifted from the kind of philosophy of being okay with just having temporary items and trusting a centralized database to now being like, no, we want to own our money. Look what, you know, the whole reason Bitcoin came about, it was written in 2008, and the whole reason that the very first block was signed with, I think, is it an article about the economic collapse? Satoshi put that in the first block because it's so relevant to the fact that people were sick of, you know, banks taking our money, using our money to make money for themselves, overstepping because they want to make too much money, and then causing crashes. And so people wanted to actually own their money, and I think Bitcoin and cryptocurrency generally is true ownership of your money. And I think digital assets, in-game items, they go together so well, and I think that we're going to see a big, I mean, we're already seeing it. As I said, we've seen the statistics, you know, the amount of money that's going into trading, whether it's crypto keys, or guns, and this really is the
very start of it. I mean, we move to a world with artificial intelligence and virtual reality, where it could quite literally be what you have done in a virtual world, which has been created for you by artificial intelligence, spending a virtual currency in a private community.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, completely. I mean, as we've already discussed, like, virtual currencies are not a new thing, especially for the gaming industry. We know what they are, we know how to use them, we know how they're involved in games. And so if you couple blockchain and cryptocurrency with that, then I think you've got kind of winning opportunity.
So Gary, you've got a token sale, ICO, coming up shortly. What's kind of keeping you up at night? What have you been doing?
My lack of understanding. as I say, it's been a steep learning curve.
Because obviously that can be quite daunting for people.
Yeah.
How have you found, I mean, my background's venture, and actually when I spoke to people in the VC community and said, I'm going to get into the token economy, ICOs. First of all, most people had to look at what they were, and then when they looked at what they were, they thought, you know, you've gone mad. And now they're actually sending people to events, and they're actually participating. So you are bringing a kind of an older world into a much newer, younger world.
Yeah.
How's it been embraced? How have you sort of been received?
Absolutely brilliantly, surprisingly well. I think the important thing is to bring in smart people who do have a greater grasp than I do, particularly, of certain aspects of it. The blockchains are complicated, at least, to learn from a standing start.
How would you describe it to somebody? If you're at a dinner party and someone said to you, what is this blockchain?
I'd hope they'd be really pissed by it. Put me on the spot here. Because I have been asked many, many times, and every answer has always been different, because it's basically a digital ledger, because everyone equates, everyone's perception of blockchain is Bitcoin. Blockchain is Bitcoin. And blockchain isn't Bitcoin. Blockchain is a virtual ledger that securely holds information, whether it's financial transactions or assets, in a very, very secure way, an anonymized way also, that is a decentralized...
the best one that was ever told to me, but I use it as if it's my own now, was it's like going to the fairground and you are given a bag of tokens to enjoy all the rides. But before you can get on a ride, there are 100 people who are actually going to check that that token allows you to get on the ride. And unless those 100 people agree, you're not getting on the ride.
Yeah, that's
that's a
much easier way. But I just give up. Because
so your advice to somebody who is in this room, they've built games before, they're looking at the blockchain, and they're looking at tokenization, would be study it, read it, go for it, dive in.
But there's two very, very different elements. One is you need to understand the blockchain, how to legitimately leverage your economy to take advantage of it. And the last speaker had a perfect example.
But the games industry, this is the wonderful thing, I think, about the space. The games industry have done this for so long. This is, you know, creating private economies, creating virtual economies, you know, entire worlds which thousands of people, hundreds of thousands of people live in, but nobody outside of that world actually even are aware of.
Yeah, but the big difference is you amass your wealth and to spend within that economy. What you don't generally do, and there are exceptions, is trade.
Yeah.
And that's what a big differentiator now is, that you can trade, and obviously trade for real money and increase your ownership. There are exceptions, obviously, with Warcraft and whatever. But generally, you're talking about having to have commodities in your game that can be traded, that has an intrinsic value to other people rather than just yourself.
So we're going to see more and more people buying crypto assets, creating crypto assets, trading crypto assets, more people becoming aware of what a crypto asset is.
That's right, and that way you can legitimately leverage the blockchain for your ICO. Otherwise, you're just looking at reversing your existing game into something that sounds magical and a way of raising money, but it's
they
not
call it
legitimate.
It's a reverse ICO.
But the problem is, with that sort of mentality, you're not going to increase the value of your token. Yeah. And at the end of the day, that's what everyone wants to do.
Indeed, and founders should be incentivized in the correct way with vesting schedules.
Yep.
People who are getting significant discounts should be incentivized to hold those tokens through lock-in periods. And is those some of the things that you've been sort of discovering on your journey?
Yeah, I mean, there are different ways to incentivize. You're asking before. I mean, one way is you can still incentivize with equity of the company, because the way I sort of evaluated the opportunity of the one I'm involved with is, does this work as a business in its own right?
Yeah.
Or is the ICO element, is the blockchain element, just a gimmick, just capitalizing on a trend, so that the business needs to work well in its own right? Then, of course, you can build the business as you do traditionally, and perhaps the equity in that business will have a value.
So you think you could create, ultimately, a scalable and sellable business?
I think that's one way of looking at it, and if you're confident that you can do that, then you look at the blockchain economy within that business. That's another facet. So you're looking at two different businesses in a way. One is the core business that we've always had to look at.
The software developed game.
And then the other one is, of course, the economy within that game, which is a different business in itself. It's related, but it is separate in some way, and you want that to be successful also. So the game, let's call it a game, could be successful. You have millions of players, and it's hugely successful, and everyone loves it. But the economy itself may not work. It may not be profitable in its own right. It may not be investable in its own right. And that's something you have to assess, because, of course, if it doesn't stand the test of scrutiny, by the investors, they're not going to invest in it. Yeah, the game's going to be great, but I'm not investing in the game. I'm investing in the economy.
Okay, very helpful, Mary. Peter? So are you very bullish on the space? understandably. What are the bear traps, though? What really, and I'm not here talking about trading, okay. I'm talking here about the token economy. We're very much in the infancy of this space. What keeps you up at night? What are you seeing? What's, you know, in terms of, is it business culture? What's kind of worrying you?
Strange question, probably a strange answer. What worries me is the amount of people trying to be traders who really shouldn't be.
Right.
Most people shouldn't be traders. Some shouldn't really even be investing. And there is a difference between the two. It's very speculative. It's very easy to lose your money. And if you're not doing this for a time, it can be a very expensive lesson. And I know people, and I've read stories of people who've lost a lot of money. So it's not a quick buck. And if you do not understand how markets operate, and you do not understand price action, and how market makers manipulate markets, you can very easily get lost chasing something. The risk for the tokenization is people raising money, thinking this is the only way to raise capital, do so within the speculation bubble, expecting to raise a lot of money, and they don't. And then also how they manage the treasury of what they raise, that would also worry me. So if I was ever to, I do consult on some projects, but if I was to consult on ICO, treasury management would probably be one of the most important things.
And it's very rare you see that in a white paper.
Most people haven't even heard of it.
Yeah, I mean, I was asked to advise a group, and I said to them, I said, I can't because I've got no time commitment. I said, but one thing I really need to say to you, and I've seen this happen, is KYC and AML is so important. Because if you want to be able to do what you want to do, which is to deploy this into kind of a physical real world, then you need to have, you know, done that. And they said, well, what's KYC and AML? And for anybody who is ultimately wanting to go out on a journey and raise, I think, the 30 to 50 million that they were looking to raise, that was kind of, for me, quite a worrying signal.
And I think also a lot of people, by skipping the venture layer, going straight to ICO, you're actually missing a very important layer of support, advice, and guidance you get from venture capital. You're missing mentorship, you're missing a bunch of people who've done this before, and you're missing often maturity. So again, referring to the guys out in Santa Monica, they've got guys who went to raise 2 million on an ICO, and that, because of what's happened to Ethereum over the year, these guys are set on tens of millions, and they're turning up in private jets, and they're not even building a product. So the thing that worries me is that this is going to crash, and actually, what a big crash could do is bring regulation into market, which will be a real shame, because the lack of regulation has actually opened up this economy.
It's what's driving much of the innovation has actually happened because of the lack of regulation.
Yeah, totally. And look, I'm a hypocrite. I'm in it for the money, of course. I'm in it for an easy life, and it's a chance to, you know, and it's exciting. There's a whole bunch of reasons, but I trade to make money. It's my job. But the greed of the market is just dangerous for a lot of people on a lot of different levels. Both as personal investors and business.
Yeah, I mean, I think somebody who's again sat on both sides of the table, it horrifies me that there is no treasury management. People don't understand even what a hardware wallet is. They don't know where they're going to store their funds. They don't understand how they're going to open a real bank account. They have no external oversight whatsoever. They can pay themselves whatever they want. I've yet to see a white paper which actually even details what the executives of the business intend in paying themselves. And I think if you talk about transparency and trust, you actually need to open yourself up to a higher level of scrutiny, either, again, through self-regulation, otherwise people are going to be asking, you know, what have you done? When businesses, you know, sadly sometimes fail, people are usually quite forgiving if people have been trustworthy and honest. But if ultimately you raise 10 million in an ICO, but deciding that the appropriate salary for you is $1 million a year, then perhaps people are going to start to ask some questions.
Yeah, and the other thing though, conversely, I obviously think bubbles are a good thing. Most people screw about, this is a bubble. And
well, from bubbles, we saw Amazon and Google.
Yeah, and Amazon and Google, you know, we have a very strong housing market in the UK, and tulips are still popular in Holland. So listen, out of bubbles come very good things. It creates an arms race. It creates. You end up finding really good projects. The problem is they usually happen within some form of regulation. Yeah. This bubble isn't happening within any form of real regulation. Yeah. So, you know, that worries me. I tell you something else that worries me. It's slightly different. Smart contracts worry me. And Turing complete systems worry me. Yeah. I tell you the reason they worry me is the ability to destroy smart contracts.
So let's just for the audience, just define a smart contract.
So some of you will have heard of Ethereum. Ethereum, and by the way, I'm not technical, so if I get something wrong, jump in. But a smart contract is the ability to execute a contract within a cryptocurrency or a crypto protocol.
And it's not that smart. I mean, it's a set of protocols.
There are protocols and rules, but some smart contracts have been frozen and have been attacked. There was one on a wallet recently that froze. It's 100 million.
100 million, and that was one of the co-founders of the Ethereum.
Yeah, I don't believe we truly know these smart contracts are going to work. And sadly, a smart contract within a decentralized system probably can't always be rolled back. So I think it's a real threat to the actual rollout of smart contract-based systems within huge companies, big companies, traditional companies. Yeah. That worries me.
So we have smart contracts there, and then you mentioned Turing.
Turing Complete is that would be better explained by you, but my understanding is that you can code anything.
Right.
You have a full language to develop anything you want.
Right.
And I don't think we need this. Actually, I think we need more simple systems which are less difficult to break, because there is so much incentive within this market to break, hack, and destroy that it makes these become commercially viable systems for blue chip companies actually quite difficult.
I think that's what...
It's too much risk.
I think a lot of people in this space, and this is why it's great that the game space can look at it, is actually what drives mass adoption is these people called consumers. And you actually look at so many of the projects which are coming into the market, and hey, they are solving incredibly difficult challenges, potentially, but they're actually not too far away from the academic projects. Science-based projects, and maybe that's not a bad thing. If people are going into these, they've made so much money out of Bitcoin and Ethereum, if actually they can place some of this into what are effectively academic matters, then that's not a bad thing.
No, not at all. Look, it's a great space. I think it's really exciting. I don't think any of us truly understand, during the early days of the dot-com, I was very lucky. I was a coder at HTML. I was very lucky to get in right at the early stage. Nobody foresaw Facebook. Everyone foresaw commerce. So everyone tried to build these commerce platforms, and we had a lot of failures with boo.com and such. And out of that, we discovered all these projects around social media, social engagement, and people. So Web 2 really was about people-to-people connection. The problem is all this is now centralized around a few businesses. Facebook controls one aspect, Google controls, and actually, I don't think that is particularly good for them. I think it's actually inefficient on a capital level, on a personal capital level. The great thing about the blockchain is that by decentralizing it, it will have a better spread of income and capital. So I think it's a really exciting space. I just don't think most of us know what are going to be the main projects that come out of it. We still find it out. So rather than the things I worry about, I'd rather focus on things I'm excited about, that actually this is not going away.
And what are you most excited about? What's...
I bought 260,000 pounds of mining gear from China the other week, and I sent it within half an hour of the invoice coming in. It was scary to do it, but I got a confirmation within half an hour, and the order was made, confirmed. There is no other way I can make an order of China that amount of money without getting someone poking at me and wanted to know. And plus, the fee was about $12 for 260,000 international transfer. That excites me. The fact that you can move money around that quickly, that really excites me. I'm excited by decentralized projects which take control away from small groups of people.
Yeah. And that could mean completely new ways that we view even things like employment.
Yeah, but let me give you an example. Uber, for me, whilst really useful, is not on an ethical level a good business for society. Because essentially, it takes a little bit more away from every taxi driver and puts it in the hands of a few guys at the top, a few venture guys. If you had a decentralized Uber, then actually there's nobody to push the money to the top. It's just a better system of trust, yet the economics for the taxi driver stays the same. So I find something like that really exciting.
We're going to pick it up. We've got about 3 or 4 minutes left. I'd like to do a couple of questions from Pat as well. 2018, still time to kind of do predictions. What do you kind of expect to see during the next sort of 11 months, which are left of the year?
I think we're going to see a lot more large ICOs, successful ones. We're going to see an awful lot or failures.
Do you think we'll start to see the first of the 2015-2016 projects starting to hit?
They should do, and those are necessary to imbue confidence in the investment community to drive more investment into ICOs. There's a trust issue, there's a lot of scams out there, so we must sort out chat from the week. What's happening now is because there are a lot more ICOs, there's a lot more scrutiny in the white paper, in the projects that people are presenting, so there's hopefully no more emperor's new clothes, and that will certainly, hopefully, eliminate a lot of the scams.
I think this is where, one of the panels I did last week, we were saying, you know, there is no regulation in this space, which is completely and utter rubbish, because there is a lot of regulation. If you're out there to commit fraud or you are committing a securities offence, that regulation is there, and you know it will result in you potentially wearing an orange suit for a long period of time in a country you don't want to go to.
Depending on where the people are.
The
ICO is coming out of, I won't say mention a country, but certain countries, they're probably untouchable.
Well, the SEC see themselves as an international organisation. If you take money from Americans, then they'll
try and come and get you.
And they probably would. Okay, Jake, a final one for you. 2018 predictions. You've traded currency for a long time. Where do you see things going?
Yeah, I think we'll continue to see money flow in. I think we're at a point, you know, the start of 2018, following on from 2017, where we had 6 months in 2017 that just saw total market capitalization of cryptocurrency as a whole just explode upwards. Everyone's seen charts, everyone's seen the ridiculous spike up.
I mean, I called 350 as the final figure to finish the year off, and I'm embarrassed as to how I thought that's punchy enough.
But I think everyone at the moment is, because as we mentioned before, we have a lot of newbie traders coming in. You know, Pete said about how some of these people probably shouldn't be involved. They're the people who will be ringing me up and anyone else who's involved in cryptocurrency, and they'll be saying, should I sell? And it's good that there's more people getting involved. It's a democratic kind of thing, and decentralization requires a lot of involvement. But at the same time, like, a lot of people are going to get burnt, a lot of people have done. Unfortunately, a lot of ICOs, a lot of projects that have been, as I said, initiated in 2015, as early as that, they still haven't brought a project out. Like, there is no product. But I mean, for example, Augur, if you've ever heard of that, that's like quite an early ICO. It was a price prediction market, so people would essentially make predictions, and if you're right, you can get. It's like a gambling. And they had aimed to, I think, come out in early 2016, and they still haven't brought anything out. But it was such a good idea.
Well, I mean, look at people like Tezos. They've got a few challenges which are still ongoing, which probably explains why I'm not a big fan of foundations, unless a foundation is truly needed for the project. So we're going to start to see the first kind of ICOs hitting the wall, which will start to kind of shake up the market.
Well, we'll actually see utility of these blockchains as well. At the minute, it's all this talk about, oh yeah, you can do this with the blockchain, do that. It's like, will somebody do it? The problem is with CryptoKitties, which is a good example of a game or a trading card game, given that they are just pictures on your screen, crashing the Ethereum network, sending the price of transactions up, and slowing everything down for everyone. So if one game where you trade two kittens and breed them together, and that, if that's going to crash or at least slow down a network,
we've got
a long way to go, and everybody knows about scalability.
So lots of new blockchains coming out. We're going to be interested to see which get adoption. They claim that they can solve the problems. In fact, actually, some of them are demonstrating it right now, so they are real. So that's going to, I think, very, very interesting. We've got time, I think, for one question. If we've got anybody who's got a burning question for any member of the panel. Fantastic. It means we've covered absolutely everything.
Very quickly, you mentioned the book about valuing
Chris Minetsky. Crypto. If you just search Chris Minetsky on Amazon. Also, there's a guy called John Pfeffer, John Pfeffer. He just did a white paper about crypto asset valuation, and he covers how both protocols would overvalue Bitcoin and Monero are undervalued. It's really good.
David Siegel, the Token Handbook, is a very good guide to his view on tokens and token.
John will say Bitcoin for dummies.
Thank you. Or reading lists for Super. So, thank you very much to our panel. Yeah.